and thank you this morning to everyone for leading us in worship. My name is Moses Barrio, and it's so good to have you with us this morning, whether you're here visiting for the first time or if you're online. I am the senior pastor of Calvary by Sea, and my pronouns are he, him, and his. I am an Indigenous American of Mayan descent, and you know, although I acknowledge that the violence and genocide upon my ancestors, my colonizers, I also choose this morning to acknowledge the engineering, the artistry, the science of my ancestors. There's this Mayan proverb I shared a few weeks ago, and it just says, do not look up to the clouds, or your work will not progress. So I say to you this morning, walk in progress, my relatives, walk in progress. I have a story to share with you of a friend, he's a pastor, told me about his mentor, would say that his pastor would end every service on his knees with his hands upward, with tears on his face. And that was the image of the pastor, the mentor of my friend. Similarly, as a young boy and as a young adolescent, I too observed my grandmother and great-grandmother every morning. Early in the morning, before the sun even appeared at the foot of their bed, they were kneeling, praying, with hands facing upward. Those were my mentors. That's what I think of when I think of what a pastor is. I think of my grandmother, my great-grandmother. I think of their prayer and of their hands facing upward. There's something about prayer, right? It moves one beyond oneself. It somehow moves us from independence to interdependence, from self-importance to world-importance, from praying with oneself to truly speaking with the divine. Now, by the end of prayer, by the end of that conversation, that dialogue, one walks away with knowing more about oneself through the eyes of the Creator. Who does the Creator say I am? What is the true version of self through the eyes of the Creator? I believe today's wisdom, today's parable, I hope it speaks to you in such a way that it spoke to me this way. And this week, as I read it, I titled today's sermon, God Dwells in Authenticity. You see, the images of this parable, they're very stark in comparison. There is a dualistic nature, right, to this parable. There are two characters pinned up against one another. The two men are praying, the two men are speaking the same thing, mostly. But they're not just the same thing. Both characters carry a bias, an assumption. The Pharisee represents an upright, religious, and pious person. The tax collector is the epitome of a sinner, a thief, a traitor. And this distinction should make the reader pause. So to examine one's biases, one's assumptions of these two characters. Did you hear how the Pharisee used language about himself? It seems to me like the language he was using is kind of this vibe of elitism. It kind of has this self-importance, while the tax collector's language seems to be simple and clear and wholehearted. The Pharisee does not seem to be praying with God, rather seems to be praying with himself, informing God of how good he is. And somehow the Pharisee sees himself as separate from the rest of humanity, and it has to let the teaching process unworthy, being obsessed, informing of who he truly is. Somehow the Pharisee also stands by himself, if you catch that, so not to be contaminated by those who are more unclean than him, while the tax collector stands far off to signify, I'm not worthy to even come close. But what if this whole wisdom this morning is about one standing further is in fact nearer and closer to the divine. And I think this is where we can imagine this morning a space where we can hear the divine speak to us, where we can feel the words of God being spoken to us. Because today's parable is for the religious people. Where are all my religious people? For the Pharisees of today, or also this today's sermon is for all the tax collectors in the room. What if you are all simultaneously both? One for both the Pharisees and the tax collectors. By the way, that's my dog, that's Molly. She's just like, she's going to bark all day, by the way. What if simultaneously you are both sinners and sinners? Did you hear me? What if simultaneously we are both sinners and sinners? Both a Pharisee and a tax collector. That whether we do the right thing or make the right choice, or mistakenly do the wrong thing or make the wrong choice, God's grace remains. Forgiveness remains. Because forgiveness and righteousness is not based on us, it's based on God's grace in Jesus Christ. We say that we depend on the divine, and yet the most core of our beliefs is self-dependence, trusting more in our religious practices and in ourselves than in the divine. Do you know what Martin Luther considered sin? The failure to trust God. Today's wisdom is universal. Because I believe it belongs to any religion, it certainly doesn't belong to Christianity. Jesus belongs to no religion. Jesus and his wisdom belongs to the entire world. And when we live simultaneously as saints and sinners, we learn to depend, we learn to trust in God. And therefore, we learn to trust who the Creator says we are, our authentic selves, who we are meant to be in this world. Did you realize that there is only one of you in this world? Do you not think it matters? So what can we learn this morning from this parable? Perhaps this, that arrogance, pride, egotism, self-importance are clear obstacles towards knowing our authentic self. I'll say that one more time. That arrogance, pride, and egotism, and self-importance are clear obstacles towards knowing our authentic self. That somehow it distorts the view of self, the view of others, the view of God, and that somehow humility, obedience, meekness enhances our view of itself. And this is why I believe this parable is often about authenticity. I was just at a pastor's conference in Palm Springs, California, with over 100 ELCA pastors, and we had these wonderful speakers, and one of the most compelling things shared by one of the speakers is the necessity for authenticity in the world, the necessity for authenticity in self, and of course, in our churches. People are tired of trickery, of disinformation, of hypocrisy, they're tired of it. And I know that humanity is almost like organically thinking towards the perspective of the divine, because the Creator also looks beyond the outside. 1 Samuel 16:7 says, God doesn't look at things like humans do. Humans see only what is visible to the eyes, but the Lord sees into the heart. So do you see how there is this, for me, a sign of human reconciliation of feeling that somehow our eyes, our human eyes, are becoming more like God's eyes. That we too are looking for authenticity, and that's a good thing. But guess what? Religious practices, they can only resist what truly draws us to the divine, what truly connects us to one another, to self, is being honest about our weaknesses, our misery, our mistakes, our failures, our biases, our assumptions, and our need for dependence of God. You know, I sometimes wonder, does American Christianity need a colossal dose of authenticity? This is true. For too long, banking strategy, For too long, listen to this, American Christianity has thrived on the myth of exceptionalism, believing that their history is made up only of beauty and roses and perfume and blessings. And I attribute that myth to a lack of understanding of history, the history of the American Christian Church. When one believes that we have this great American economy because somehow America has been chosen by God, or to believe that we have this great American religion that will save all the world that is lost and going to hell, because God is with America. Well, that's so fast. Those are mystical, theological beliefs. Did you know that the majority of Christians today are not in America or in Europe? Rather, they are in Africa, Asia, and Latin America. In fact, historians and missiologists project that in the next 40 years, 80% of Christians will be of non-European descent. Did you hear that? This is an amazing thing to hear. And what's even more alarming, listen to this, is what my mentor, Tim Chan-Ra, has been extensively writing for the last 20 years, that even within the American Christian Church, this is true as well. Mainly since 1965, the influx of immigrants has brought diversity, and now America will be more Christian because of the Korean church being brought to America, because of the storefront Latinx churches popping up everywhere. And as the white evangelical and white Protestant church continues to decline, the heart, the vibrancy, the vitality of Christianity will no longer be found in prototypical white, wealthy, middle-class, suburban neighborhoods. Rather, it will be found within the cities, urban centers, among Asian, Latinx, and Black churches that are growing, among immigrant first and second generation churches, among multi-ethnic churches. You see, I wonder, would it not fare well for American Christianity to experience a season of lament, a season of confession, a season of repentance, to put on the heart of the tax collector in this parable, to put on honesty, authenticity, vulnerability? And you know what I often hear? I hear the complete opposite. I hear how leaders and pastors and people rather continue the facade to cover up things, to continue the fabrication of what history is, and it's not so exceptional at all. How can it be? A country, a religion that steals lands and calls themselves still exceptional. Enslaving black bodies for free labor and call themselves exceptional. How can a country and a religion mistreat and abuse immigrants over and over again and call themselves exceptional? To colonize peoples, cultures, countries, and still consider themselves exceptional, to judge and discriminate the sexuality, the gender, the love between two humans, and still claim exceptional. If you guess what I'm saying to you this morning, is when I think of this parable, of this wisdom, I think of Jesus attempting to highlight how important it is to be authentic. Authentic with self, authentic with others, and authentic with God. That it's not so much about the things from the outside, but it's more about the things from the inside. It's not so much about the things people can see, it's more about the things people cannot see. That the days of trying to cover up things, trying to make it look pristine and beautiful and all put together, that those things are no longer needed. What is needed today, what people are asking for, what people are craving for, is honesty, authenticity, to take responsibility. How is it that we still believe that we can lie to God, who knows us so well? You see, if there's anything that's wisdom teaches us this morning, is that God dwells in the authenticity, that God dwells in the inside. Yet, we try to put put up a front. We try to make ourselves look another way. But the reality is that God is so interested in what's going on the inside. You know, I know this is a lot for us to listen to and hear. And I wonder if I can give you a minute or two this morning to take a deep breath, to pray, to reflect, to consider what is the divine saying to you. The beauty of this exercise that we get to listen. We get to listen quietly. We get to be fully present, attentive. What does this wisdom ask of you? What is this saying to you? Let's do that. Jesus, the Christ, the visible image of the invisible God, who existed before anything was created and is supreme over all creation. All things were created by Him, through Him, and for Him. Are you hearing me? That Jesus died on the cross for both the Pharisee and the Pharisee. Takes away our sins, our burdens, our mistakes, our failures, our lack of authenticity. And gives us His forgiveness, His grace, His acceptance, and His righteousness. And resurrected from the dead, 3 days later, to give us an impact of reality, the omega point of history, liberation. But what shall we do with such an undeserving gift? What shall we do? Why would Jesus do such a thing for a sinner like me, a forgiven sinner like me? Why? I would beat myself. I cannot look up to the heavens. I would stand far off to declare how unworthy I am, and I would plead for mercy. And when I receive that mercy, when I receive that, I would acknowledge just how generous our transformation. And I will attempt to emulate that God, to emulate that generosity and mercy for all. O Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer, who was, who is, and who is to come, give us courage. Courage to be our authentic self. Courage to be vulnerable, to be open, to be moldable, to be authentic, to not judge, but to first consider our weaknesses. Help us to trust in You over all things of this world. And help us to be generous in love and mercy and in grace. Word of God and word of life. And we all say together, thanks be to God.